Cincinnati, Ohio. Everybody knows everybody else. Hey, how many introductions do we need to do here? I'm Richard Wagner, president of the Arts Trust, and God, like, raise your hand if you don't know someone here. But I guess just for form's sake, why don't we introduce ourselves going down the row with our newest board member.
Hi, my name is Jenny Mayer. Nice to meet you all and to see people I've met before. I'm the newest member. I've been working with the Center for the Arts for a year now on their board. And now Penny has left the board of the Arts Trust and I have stepped in. So here we go.
I'm Lisa Thompson and I represent APE and I've been on the Arts Trust board since the very beginning.
I'm Sam Rush. I'm the New Century Theater's producing director, and I've been serving on the board of the Arts Trust, and also have another job at Smith College in the theater department.
I'm Dorothy Nemitz. I'm the chair of the board of the Center for the Arts, and I am the clerk of the board of the Arts Trust, and I've been on since very early on, pretty much at the beginning.
I'm Bob Sillman. I used to be the director of the Northampton Arts Council. Now I'm the director. Now I'm still the director of the Young Art Chorus.
And you're on the Arts
Trust. And I'm the Arts Trust. I don't think it was the beginning, but
yeah, I think it was the beginning.
Yeah. I'm Penny Burke. I'm the director of the Northampton Center for the Arts. Recently, actually off the Arts Trust board, although I spent some time, but I am involved in the capital campaign for the Arts Trust, and I'm the person who is responsible for the interim use of the space before we begin renovations here.
I'm Tom Douglas. I'm the architect working with these guys to renovate this building.
And I'm Kathy Couch. I've been on the Arts Trust board since the beginning. I'm on the APE board.
And I'm Richard, and I'm on nobody's board. I'm one of the, Peter Whalen and I are the two, and Stephen Pettigorsky. No, Stephen's on the Arts Council. Yeah, no, Peter Whalen and I are the only civilians. So we're the civilian reps. I forget how long I've been doing this, but for like 3 years or something like that. All these guys are great. And so, look, you all know what this is about. I mean, we're here, we bought this building to create a space that will remain open to the Northampton community for a very long time. And the mindset I have, and I think the mindset everybody else has, was reflecting a conversation we had when we were talking with First Churches people, and they were like, we've been here 200 years, how about you? So that, when I think about this project, that's what I think about. I have a shelf life. I mean, everybody has a shelf life, but this organization, this space, this property will be, down the years, forever dedicated to creative work in one form or another. So you all know that. What you don't know are the latest design ideas. So I think I'm just going to turn it over to Tom, have him explain where we are with the design, and then just, I want to hear from you guys. If you have questions, if you have concerns, especially as neighbors, as a neighborhood, you know, impacts, things of that sort. And we'll just talk about it. So this is being taped for the
North Street Association.
North Street Association. Anyone have a problem with that? No? So you're good to go.
Thank you.
I'm going to turn it over to Tom. While he's doing his thing, I'm going to go downstairs and get a pair of pliers to see if I can turn on this fan. So, Tom, it's yours.
So I'm a Northampton architect. I have an office over on Pleasant Street above Yes Computers. And I've had a firm here in Northampton for about 25 years, and I've worked on a lot of downtown projects. We, a long time ago, did the Calvin Theater renovation. We're working on the Academy of Music interior renovation now. Designed a lot of restaurants, and so done lots of hospitality-type work. And I've been involved with Penny and the Center for the Arts for like 3 years now. I think just looking at different spaces. This is the fourth building, I think, that they
looked at. 40th, I think.
While I was with them, so we looked at three others prior to this. None of them really suited our needs for various reasons, and then we landed on this, and this is such a great space, but needs a lot of thought and effort given to it. So I'll just walk you through the, this is the site plan here. So this is Holly Street out here, and then this is our building right now as it exists, and this is the, are the additions that we're planning for. So this gray area here is the parking lot. I was surprised that it went back so far, but it's a huge amount of parking back here. Are the people here who ever went to this gym, or yeah, you guys went to this gym? Okay. Was it really open 24 hours a day?
Yes.
In the last year.
Oh, okay. Were the people coming and going all 24 hours? Yeah. Okay. Then were there many? I'm sorry to get off track, but I was just curious about that.
Sometimes you couldn't get in.
Was the parking lot ever filled up?
No.
Okay. So the usage you feel has been minimal for a bunch of years, you think? Or
it was very active.
Yeah, I remember I bought tools here. I remember that. Yeah, so you had tractor trailers coming and going here for a long time. I heard the building that was here before burned down, and this was the replacement. So this was built in the 80s, I think, right? So basically what we're going to do is we're going to renovate this existing building here and then add an addition to the front of it. That's my wife. It's not my point. This is a rendering of what the front will look like. We're sort of midway through the project now, and the reason we're having this community meeting is in a couple months we're going to go before the planning board, and that'll be a formal public hearing where you're welcome to come and voice your opinions. But we wanted to get your opinions before that meeting, just so since we're midway through the project, we could make some adjustments along the way before up here at that planning, that public hearing, where everything gets very rigid and everybody has to take the turn speaking and so on and so forth. This is supposed to be a much more informal setting where you really voice your ideas. But again, this is the front of the building. These are additions that we're adding to it. So basically, on one end, there would be a little catering kitchen, which is down here. This would be an outdoor seating area for cafe and informal events. This is basically box office area, the entry, and then storage area on the end. And then, so you can see back here, that gray area is the building that we're in right now. We're going out about 12 feet. So we're getting a survey now. We still don't know exactly where the property boundary is up there. We'll definitely be inside of the property boundary, and there'll be a sidewalk out there. But we are going to be tighter to the street. There's pluses and minuses to that I'll talk about later on. But this is the new first floor plan. So. We are sitting right here in this room here, and this is Holly Street out here, and then this is that front door that I showed you just a minute ago. So this is the addition wrapping around the building here that we're going to add. But you would come in the front door right here, and then this would be a big lobby here. So we'd basically take out all these walls right here and create a nice big lobby with a brand new staircase that takes you downstairs. But this is the common entry area where we'd like everyone who enters the building to come in at this level. We're not really going to encourage entry at that lower level for various reasons, but we mainly want the whole community, everybody visiting here, to come into one space because we have so many things happening in the building that feed off of each other that it would be nice to have just one common entry area. So you come in the building here, you can take a right, and then come into the space we're in now. And this would be basically the replacement for the Center for the Arts ballroom. It's a little bit smaller because we have another space that's much larger. But we'd be able to seat about 100 people there, and it would be an open layout like this with, you know, chairs and risers just like this. It could be configured in every way that you can imagine. There'd be a little box office here and vestibule there. Part of this lobby would be a cafe. It's not really like a 8-hour a day, you know, convenience store or deli. It's going to be more kind of a concession stand. So it would, you could get something to eat and drink when there was a show here, or you can hang out there when your child is in a dance class or an art class here or something like that. So we're trying to create a kind of common community space here where you can hang out, wait for things to happen, visit other spaces in the building, and get something to eat or drink. To the left of it, which is now the bathrooms down on that end, this is going to be an art gallery. And the bathrooms were so huge down there because they had a bunch of showers and locker rooms and stuff. So we're going to put in a bunch more toilets, but they're going to be in a smaller space. So these are the toilets we're putting in. This is going to be an art gallery that's open to that common lobby space. So there'll be a lot of different types of shows here. You've been to APE, you've been to the shows at the Center for the Arts. It'll be a mixture of those things there. But again, open to this common lobby space. In the back is an existing dance studio. So we're going to retain that, and then they can have dance classes back here. It's fairly separate. And it's easy to get to. The floor is actually, the building is on two levels. This is this back part, when the lumber, or when the lumber yard was gone and the exercise studio took it over, they built that all up there. It used to be a two-story space when it was a lumber yard, but they built that level up there. So what we're going to do, one of the biggest things we're going to do here is to create something that Northampton doesn't really currently have, and that's this Black Box Theater here. So that whole raised floor over there you see, basically, it extends back from what you can see. We're going to cut that whole floor out right there. We're just going to take it all out, and then we're going to end up with this really big two-story space that will become a great Black Box Theater. Right? Plenty of height for lighting and sound and stage setups and things like that. So this will be a big new addition to the Northampton art scene. A couple of other little things. Here's the catering kitchen. I think I told you about. That's the outdoor seating cafe area, so that you could have a show here and then spill out here and take a break at intermission or something. This is a little gray as to how it's going to actually be used, but we're still thinking about that now. If you come in the door and you go down the stairs, where you would come to is a lower level lobby here, and you could go in the big Black Box Theater right there. That's where the main entry to that Black Box Theater here is on this level, because this is the two-story space. So you go in the theater here, and there's 200 seats there, and they would be configurable like this. It's just the Black Box is basically four walls and roof and all the lighting and sound systems you need. Black walls and a good dance floor, and no fixed seating, no fixed theatrical setup, just all the things that you need that are flexible enough to set up a theater show, and whether it's music or dance or live theater, you know, it's supposed to accommodate all those things, so totally reconfigurable. The other parts of the basement space are, this is where the kids' space was, you know, forget what they called it, Universal Kids. So we retained most of that, but we cut out some of it because of our new stair. This is where that maze, the kids' maze was, so we retained that as an art studio. So the thought is that this is mostly going to be for arts classes. It might be for some music, but it would be rehearsal space, maybe for musicians, but a multi-purpose, multi-use room, and the same with this here. This whole back area here is mechanical space and dressing rooms and green rooms and just loading in spaces. So that's all the support space for this theater and for that theater there. So the first thing we're going to do in this project is basically to strip off the exterior walls and roof of this building because they're so leaky, so much. I mean, they're poorly insulated, poorly built. It's just a simple metal building built for a lumber yard. And they didn't care. Half of it was cold or hot or whatever. But now we've got the goal of the group is to create a space for artists where they can do whatever they need to do and have very low operating costs. So the long-term goal is that they keep their operating costs of the building as low as they possibly can to give artists space and that will be at a low cost. So we're going to spend a lot of time and effort buttoning up this building, making the shell super insulated. We're going to do the same thing with the roof too. So the first thing you'll see is we're going to strip the perimeter off of the building and the roof and redo the whole thing. At the same time, we've got to put in some new steel beams that go across the space to support lighting grids for the theater space. Once we really button up the building and get it, the water out, there's a ton of squirrels that live here now, and sometimes they have maintenance issues. Richard Wagner is the Arts Trust president and the janitor here, so he's got that job. So once we get that done, and the shell is sort of tight and manageable, then we can go back and start doing the exterior additions and cutting the big hole in the floor and doing all these interior things. So it's going to be a project that probably will happen in a couple of phases, I'm thinking. Not exactly sure what the timing is because we're still in the process of shoring up all the funding sources. A project like this is such a big funding endeavor. I mean, even with a big group like this and all the connections they have, it's still a massive funding quest to get the money for a place like this. So, like I said, we're kind of in the middle of this design project, and we just wanted to get your input and your questions. So I think now I can just basically open it up to you guys for questions.
What about the solar panels?
Those are in the plan, yeah. The roof orientation would allow us to cover basically the whole roof of solar panels. There's another funding question, will we have enough money to do that? But that would bring the operating costs down.
I assume the center is the administrative office will be in the building.
Yep. They're still kind of working out who's in that office all day long, but yes, it would be staffed all day long.
Let me ask you a supply and demand question. Are there any groups that would keep this place occupied, various shows, whatever you want to do? I mean, what is the demand for this kind of space?
Yeah, kick that over to Penny or Lisa.
Yeah, so maybe what I'll do is I'll just translate. That's a good question. Unless you have any questions about the physical building, ask us now and then we can switch to
use it. There's just one? Are you showing?
Well, yeah, this is the lower level, and then if you were here, you'd be looking down at this level, so that's a two-story space.
So what's your rough vision how the exterior will look by this?
It's going to be a fairly modern looking facade. I certainly would never want to slap on a colonial addition in front of this big metal building. I feel bad about that. No, it's mostly small scale metal panels, so of different colors. But there'll be horizontal bands to it and vertical bands, but it's basically a metal panel system that's not huge panels, you know, small.
Is there any kind of any creative external illumination?
This is a canopy right here that projects out, cantilevers out over this entry here. So what you can barely see is these freestanding letters that say Arts Trust. So those would be illuminated. And then this outdoor space here would have some illumination. We have some uplights in the building, but we're really limited by what the city planning board will allow. We can't just shine lights up.
Illuminating spots.
Yes.
I could not be more pleased that a group like this has come together to renovate and restore this home to a whole other worthy public for the white man.
Well, because, you know, we're involved in a lot of zoning conversations and like what fits into a neighborhood and what doesn't fit into a neighborhood, the building never did fit into the neighborhood, this building necessarily, but is there any rendering that would show this, like, on Holly Street, like, or what it would look like to somebody, like, coming up the street, you know, and seeing this, or the neighbors, like, people who live on these streets up there. What's your sense of that?
Yeah, most of our renderings are of the building itself. It is very large. I think if so, the question really is, how does this building fit into a small scale neighborhood? That's basically the question. I think, in a way, because we can't like take this building and make it smaller, but we can add to it with elements that are of a smaller scale. So that was part of the push, was to make our addition have a much more detail and be a smaller scale. And sort of get the gigantic building in the background and then it kind of cascades down to the street. So that the lower scale in the front is much, much more pedestrian friendly. So we're hoping that as you walk down the sidewalk, the pedestrian experience would be far nicer than what it is now. You know, I just can't imagine a worse entry. So, you know, it is a commercial building. It is a fairly modern design. But I think that the scale of it is going to be really nice, really pleasing, and inviting too. So it'll have some color. It's not going to be cold and hard, and you know, modern. We want it to be open and friendly and appealing, and of the scale of the neighborhood, but not the same materials and not the style, same style. So.
Are you going to have catch water and cistern systems for like gray water toilets and that kind of thing?
We haven't gotten to that point yet. I know Richard, as there was a group of Smith students who did a class here to talk about issues exactly like that. So I'm not there yet. We've been tackling the energy conservation issues in the other half of the water. We have no water urinal stuff.
Right.
There's like one massive culvert that runs back there that you supposedly could walk in. You'll have to ask me that another
time. All right, we'll give you a while.
Curious to know, Brian, who could answer this, but where does the money come for this project?
Okay, well,
we're looking at you.
Yeah. are there any more specific questions for Tom?
So the train platform is just coming in not far away.
Yeah, that's right.
Have you given thought to, you can't physically connect really to the train platform, how this would look, you just get off the train, and you can be able to see that. You know, maybe someone has taken the train in the future to come here. Is it going to be identifiable from that vantage point?
Sign on the back.
I mean, it's a very, very quick route. I walk from my office to here, you know, in less than 5 minutes. So it's an easy route, but you have to walk right across two tracks. I don't know that the train would ever officially allow you to walk across the tracks.
No.
The city would have to build an overpass.
Or a tunnel. We could build
it.
I've spoken with Jerry Moran about that. He was not, he was just, you know, getting into his project. So thinking about opening up the backside of the tunnel boat was a bit much fun. But it allegedly is there. So, in the future.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be great if the platform's over there, if there was some room over here, but how that could happen and who would pay for this.
Nice if it were this center where it's visually identifiable and you're standing there.
Yeah.
Well, where am I going? Oh, it's up there.
Right.
Well, it's something to think about, having the name of the building on the back side of it and visible from the train platform.
Yeah.
Actually, I hadn't thought about that.
I see some car dealerships with giant inflatable gorillas.
Yeah,
I think that's hard in the neighborhood pretty well.
And that does not include, there's that little play area back there. We haven't decided what might happen there, but that's always available. And, you know, we didn't really want to do it, but it could be asphalt. I mean, I got to tell you, when the Smiths students came to do the Shoretta stormwater and stuff, nearly all of the designs were like, turning the parking lots into gardens, lawns and stuff. And it would be nice, because people love green space, but people love parking. And we understand that, so at the moment we have a lot of parking.
Are there any stipulations against using the property for things like contract parking during the week or anything like that?
Absolutely no idea.
You mean shared parking with somebody?
No, as in cost money to park
like
here and
make
money.
Oh,
money.
Oh, yeah, you own the parking lot.
It's private parking. It's a private.
I'm just suggesting.
So one could do that.
Yeah,
it's
right. There's a lot of new charges for parking spaces.
That's
just
right.
Like
that.
That's pretty prime stuff.
Yeah.
Here, Waylon North Sea. My only other civilian. Peter should have a seat. Yeah, so.
Did he say he's going to do rough budgets? Any ideas of what the future of this is going to
be? We do, but I don't know that that should be a part of this hearing.
A lot.
Yeah, Joel, you asked the question. I mean, I can tell you, thus far, from the board, we've raised, have pledges, a little bit north of $2 million. I mean, we own this building. This building is no dental. It is ours. The renovation is going to cost a lot, and we've been working on a budget that just bumped up, and really, I'm going to agree with Tom. I don't want to go into that now because we need to go back and we need to start figuring out how we can pull things back a bit.
And in all fairness, you really only have to through the design process, so it's really unfair of you to ask what it's going to cost.
Yes.
Yeah, but I mean, we are working very hard to identify that number because we have to start a capital campaign to support the renovation. So that has to launch sooner rather than later. So this is something which is foremost on my mind and everyone else's mind.
We have already received two grants from the state. For $180,000 from, I don't even know what office it was. It was a community development and tourism grant. And we received $140,000 from the Mass Cultural Council Facilities Fund. So we've already, you know, got some good support there. We'll continue to explore grant offers.
In addition, just
so how long do you estimate it's going to take to take off the outside and put on the new outside? In terms of just noise, I don't actually live in this back neighborhood, but some people do live from right around. And so what is your estimate of what it would be like for people across the street?
In terms
how long
of
will it go?
Probably going to take 2 to 3 months at least to demo the whole exterior and redo it. A good 3 months to do that. So it's going to be your typical construction zone. It's just part of the process.
Very
we have
normal.
To go through. We can't do it.
8 to 4.
Very normal construction zone.
Yeah. No, it's not. We're not going to be over here jackhammering concrete or cutting. I mean, there's going to be a crane here. We're going to be lifting in some new steel beams to support our new group and the theatrical stuff. But I think that once we insulate the walls and get the roof on, the interior work will be fairly quiet. We are going to add those additions in the exterior, and that's going to be concrete work and
we're aiming, March is the date that we have in mind now to commence renovation. And then I'll leave it to you, Tom, and I think it's going to be...
If we had all our funding in place and we went full steam ahead, it would be about a year-long project. Like I said, the goal is to try to get the exterior really buttoned up. And there's a lot of interior work here to do. So, you know, by the time winter set in, the whole building would be closed in, tight, fairly quiet, you know, in terms of noise coming out from it. And then we'd just be doing a lot of interior work. We'd put in an elevator, the new stairs, all the new bathrooms, all that plumbing, electrical, sprinklers, all that stuff. But that's all interior work. So a good 6 months of this project is going to be solely devoted to interior.
Are you doing it piece by piece so that sections of it could be used?
Or no, I don't think we can. It's too much. Once you strip the whole building down to its bare bones and you cut big holes in the middle of it, you're touching everything.
I want to go to Joel. You had the question about demand.
That, in other words, will this be used sufficiently to merit the enormous expense that you were kindly going to?
I mean, Penny, Lisa, Ginny, can any of you, Sam, can any of you speak to
Bob?
But, you know, any of the arts organization reps speak to that?
We haven't done a professional marketing study, but there is no Center for the Arts. There is no third floor of APE. It's not as if Northampton doesn't have certain entertainment venues. It's not as if we don't have an Academy of Music. But we really don't have a place for all the artists who live here to do creative work. And I guess I can only speak to what I've been involved in what we call the interim use of this building. In other words, once we got the building and it's just this, I get 4 or 5 calls every day for people who want to be here and doing things. So we have ongoing classes. We've had some events. We're very limited in terms of our technical capabilities. But, I mean, personally, my gut feeling is that this place will be in very high demand. Something like a small theater is something that really Northampton doesn't have, but also the kind of classroom and educational space, the work and process and flexible space that would be available to the artists here. I can't imagine it not being successful in that regard.
At the Northampton Arts Council, we give out grants to artists, and Stephen, I think we could safely say that about 50% of the grants that we saw in the past were either events that took place at the Center for the Arts or at the third floor of APE. So to not have those spaces is just devastating in this community. So I think, I haven't been there recently, but I think the lack of space has been a real issue. For people
it's a huge issue.
We did a show in the bottom of Thorns, the Dynamite Record space. That became an active space for groups because that was one of the most viable spaces, and that meant sharing it with a winter market, you know, so striking the show every day and then resetting up. But, you know, people are very hungry for space.
When we did this, we had a wonderful production here that Chris Roman did of Skyscraper. We had about 120 seats. We sold out every night, right up there, and that's not a theater. That was a makeshift theater. So I feel in my heart that the need is there and that the demand is there and that we'll be serving. I don't know. I don't have any doubt that we'll be full.
Lisa, Sam, you want to add anything?
Well, the you know, like up at Smith, the black box that they have up there, the Hallie Flanagan Studio Theater, I get requests daily, you know, like every week there's somebody who's investigating wanting to bring something there, and given the year and all the activities that the college has going on, it's really, really hard to carve out time for external groups, and it's not, you know, particularly sort of scientific kind of study in that, but we do get a lot of requests that we have to turn people away because we don't have, you know, they can't get into that particular space. But it does show that for a space that has about a 200 seat capacity, it's like, at least in this community, it feels like a magic number. There are spaces out there that are like 100 spaces here and there, and then there are spaces that are much larger, the Academy or the Calvin. But a 200 seat is a really wonderful size for a lot of small to mid-size arts performing groups, of which there are a number of them in this area that we just think we'll use it time and time again.
And I expect that we'll see people coming from outside the area also, that we'll get things coming through here that we've never had before because there isn't a place for them.
They just sort of said what I was going to say.
but we're not going to be having those events every night.
No.
So you talk about scheduling, how often might you be using the black box for a public event, you think?
Well, I'll speak to that because we talked about this. I think, you know, if this space can accommodate 100 people, and if we're successful in building a soundproof enough wall between this space and the black box, we could feasibly have two events going on at the same time where there might be 100 people here and there might be 200 people. So I would say maximum would be 300 people in a public performance situation, which would probably only occur on weekends.
So
most definitely not during the week. But that would be, probably that wouldn't happen very often. And it wouldn't, especially if we can't successfully, you know, solve the sound issue, it might be difficult to have simultaneous events going on. So we would have to sort of choreograph that. But we do plan to have the black box be able to accommodate up to 200 and this space up to 100. So if you could successfully have two events going on, then you're talking about 300 people.
But you're thinking during the weekdays, the activity here is...
During the weekdays, the activity would probably be no more than the 24-hour gym, maybe less than the 24-hour gym.
So
I mean, I don't...
Some classroom activity...
I mean, when you have like classroom activity during the day, you're looking somewhere between maybe 10, 20, maybe 30 people. I mean, yes, sometimes something comes up and there's a big meeting, but if I have to compare it to the Center for the Arts, I would just say that we had very moderate activity from 9 a.m. until maybe 9 p.m. on weekdays. Definitely the activity was concentrated on Friday and Saturday and occasionally Sunday nights, occasionally a Thursday night dress rehearsal, but not 52 weeks a year. Definitely not. So it's hard to say, but I mean, I would just say at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, between 5 and 6 o'clock in the afternoon, how many people used to come to the gym? Probably more than the people who would be coming here between 5 and 6 o'clock in the afternoon. And the neighborhood has, you know, withstood that. So I
think to sum it up, we believe the demand is there. I mean, I don't think this is completely fantasy. It seems, and you should go back. You all did a marketing study back to the Roundhouse, right? So, I mean, the demand for space in town, we believe, exists and will continue to exist.
I pursued this a little bit because what I've heard are really three things. I've heard music, I've heard theater, and dance. Art, that is to say, painting. I suppose there's no place to show exhibits.
The gallery.
But on those three things, I don't know how many good dance groups are there in which attract people here? How many theater groups here in the area would attract people to come and see them? And then how many music, that's probably a lot easier. There's a lot of, you have jazz groups here, you have all kinds of groups here. But
is your question more about?
I'm not speaking on behalf of the neighborhood to see how we'll be disturbed.
You're worried about the sustainability.
I'm personally thrilled that you're here. Yeah. I'm glad to have you. If you make noise to build it, too bad. That's the way it is. But what I'm concerned about is, in addition to this enormous enormous amount of money you have to borrow to do it, I mean, or get to build and do all this work, it also is going to cost to keep it going. And so I just wonder, I mean, people come and pay to get to go here, but will you have enough to maintain it, place this large, and all the expenses you have just to get it up?
Well, part of the and part of our pushing to be as efficient as possible speaks to that, is to lower the overhead costs as much as possible. And the notion is that the lessees in the building, you know, they're getting into a space that's not carrying debt, and it's very efficient, a very low overhead use of utilities. So that you know, the carrying costs to them will be low. I mean, yeah, everybody's going to have a nut that they have to make, and our job as the Arts Trust is to push that nut down as far as we can by design now. So I mean, that's the thought.
Well, to me, a scary question is, what will the city become if we don't have a space like this? You know, it's amazing to me. I mean, I watched it all happen. I was here in 76. I watched the art scene grow. I watched Spaces, watched the center happen. I watched APP come to being. I watched how important that was to this community. And, I mean, without it, I just wonder what the city's going to look like.
And what's happening is the young people are going to Holyoke. All the artists are going to Holyoke, East Hampton, all around, because space is too expensive here to create art anymore. So if we want young people here, which is what young artists is what this town was built on, Thorns, you know, the artists brought the audiences, brought the people who bought things here. If we just want to become a boutique town, that's one thing. But if we lose our core artists, we'll lose a lot of what Northampton was built on from the beginning.
And I want to get Stephen Petrovsky walked in late. He's another board member.
Thanks, Richard. And I'm sorry to have missed the beginning of what you said, but I want to just amplify something that I think everybody's touched on already, that I'm also a long-serving member of the Northampton Arts Council. So we give out grants twice a year. So twice a year we have an opportunity to see a very good measure of what the demand is in the community. And we used to have a fairly strict policy that said for applicants, if you haven't secured a venue for your proposed performance, exhibit, whatever, we're not going to look upon it very kindly, because it was a measure of the feasibility of a project for which somebody was seeking funding, whether they had secured a venue. We have had to back way off on the strictness of enforcing that stance, because there is still so much demand every round and decreased supply, specifically because of the absence of the center and what used to be the AP performance space on the third floor of Thorns. So I have absolutely no question but that the demand is there, because we see it again and again. And I think Cheryl's absolutely right that you know, what I've often said to people when I go on about this stuff is, you know, we are at the other end of the arc of gentrification in Northampton. And once certain things are lost, you know, the ability to have things at a community level for arts, they are gone. They are not coming back. They're going to be in the towns that she mentioned, in the Shelburnes, in the East Hamptons, in the Holyokes, in the places that have not yet fully gentrified. And so I, for one, you know, when I step back from this all, I see it absolutely, as Bob said, as an issue of quality of life in this community, so that we don't only become a community where the people who are here either, you know, wealthy people who have come here from richer markets and are happy to be here and, you know, take advantage of what's here, or people who are, you know, like me, lucky enough to come here many, many years ago and buy a house before it was as expensive as it is now, you know, and people, as everybody has said, you know, who enjoy the quality of life here largely in part because of the vitality of the art scene.
I want to make it perfectly clear. I mean, I love this idea. I have no problems at all. I mean, these are things that all can come to the mind of anybody who thinks about it. And what I heard, the response, I thought if artists are going East Hampton and other places, it may be true the venue isn't there to put on a play or, you know, a dance or something like that. But I thought the problem was just costs are too high for living or to have a studio here. Because the fact that you have you have beautiful figure here, that doesn't mean if I'm a young artist, and as far as studios go, we have some studios in town, I don't know, I'm not into that field, I don't know whether it works and people can show all their art. I know there's the Oxbow, which seems like reasonable for people to show their art, but my point is simply that you have to have a lot of activity when you have this kind of an institution. And if you have the activity and it's considered good, people will come. I have no doubt about that. But there have to be a lot of groups that are willing to that want to come here and use it.
And I think, if I may, you're absolutely right, and that the issues that you raise, you know, go beyond just what we're able to do here. And so that if steps aren't taken in other areas to make sure that Northampton continues to be affordable, you know, for people beyond just the wealthy, you know, if that doesn't happen, then you're right. You know, we may just get people wanting to use the space who aren't only from here, but who are from other places. So we can't take care of all those issues, but we are aware of them, you know, and hope that efforts continue to make sure that, because look, you know, yeah, you need a place to live, you need a place to rehearse, you need a place to create your work, and you need places to perform or exhibit.
We are certainly hoping that this space can provide process space as well. It won't be living space, and we don't right now have any plans whether it be visual artist studios here. But I feel like we all are certainly aware of that larger issue, and I think as a trust, we hope this isn't our only project, even though this is a huge one, and so I'm trying to take it on or imagine something beyond it. At this point, it feels daunting, but at the same time, the whole point of establishing this organization was to try to think about multiple projects that could happen and answer at different arms of this question, you know, so that there is a way for, is there art, is there work live space that can be, you know, can be found or donated, or is there this kind of studio? It doesn't all have to be of this magnitude, you know, I mean, we could also have smaller projects.
And there's something you said about if you build it, they will come on some level. I mean, we were all young people when we before, you know, we started, I mean, Young at Heart started because of the vibrant arts scene. Serious Play, yeah, and New Century Theater, the guitar stuff. You know,
it
was
Violet Ray, don't forget about Violet Ray.
Right. There's a million things that started because there was a vibrant art scene. And we got to make sure that there's still one so that, not that we can continue, but young people can start doing stuff.
And also here, the people who have left that will come back. I see that already happening.
Oh, yeah, people actually will come back. People will come back.
Area, so
I was just saying, and other people have touched on it, but, well, first of all, Ward C is one of the more affordable neighborhoods in Northampton. So we actually have really good concentration of artists. And I represent a 501c3 group that is a resident company of the Center for the Arts. And so I was just going to say it's not just a venue issue, because we have struggled to find a venue for performances, but we actually are in demand, so we can kind of play a lot of places. We have choices. But the kicker for us is rehearsal space. And we have been really benefiting from the interim use of this building. But I mean, our board, I mean, we do have some money even to pay rent, but we have exhausted the free market options. I mean, we have tried everything, and you know, we can't get a space in an industrial area. We can't be next to painters because we're too loud. You know, I mean, and people have known our plight because the Center for the Arts has spoken to it, and we have been approached many times by people in Greenfield with space that want to rent it to us. People in Holyoke have, they've been banging on our door. I mean, as far as North Africa, so people, we're clinging, you know, to stay here, and this is, you know, a major piece of things.
Also, yeah, and I would say that
I think, you know, your question about demand, or when Bob said there is a little bit of if you build, they'll come too. I've made music in community sponsored, supported art spaces all my life, and I don't know of any place. I've really not seen where someone's done this this way, the way you're just, you know, the way you're describing the goal, the mission of it, and done it that way, and it's empty. I've never seen it. I have seen it done successfully in America and in other places too, where they definitely have more money to support the arts. But even in the United States, like, I don't go to like the Newton Center for the Arts or someplace else. You don't see places made to do this, and then, gee, no one wants to use it. That just doesn't happen. It just doesn't. Now, and in fact, the idea, the radical idea here, that's great. I mean, it reminds me a lot of what happened to New York in the 80s, because when I was young, I wasn't in Northampton. I go down to New York to go see the Wooster Group, you know, and that neighborhood, you know, the Wooster Group could start making theater down there because there were all these cheap lofts to make theater and blah blah blah. And now, you know, those neighborhoods are now, you know, hedge fund managers, markets, and nobody and any place that tries to do this, like what Stephen was saying too about how, you know, the time goes by and place gentrifies. Well, even if it does gentrify, and we don't know what these costs will actually be, how low will they be? Most artists are going to tell you it's too expensive no matter what it is. That's just so true, right? I mean, no matter who you are, if it's like $10 an hour, you're going to go, really? You know, it's like if it's 100, it's just, yeah. But I believe that the activity that's going on in Holyoke, in East Hampton, in whatever, in Chicopee, in all those places, they will, people who, younger artists and not so young artists who make art out there, they want to do it here too. They still want to do it here. It's not like people left the village because they didn't like the village. They just went to Brooklyn because they couldn't afford to show their paintings anymore in the village. So if there was a place that said, well, you know, you still can show big paintings down here in the village, you know, it's not unlimited. I think the pool of people who will use it is, I think it's really important, really important in this sector.
I mean, it might be a premature talk, but we talk a lot about music and many visual arts and dance and performance, and I guess I'm still kind of mourning the loss of Pleasant Street Theater, and I'm wondering if there's been any discussions with the Education Foundation or having art still showing, particularly when there aren't expectations.
Yeah, we know there's a big demand for film. Now, this won't be a theater, you know, it's not going to be a Pleasant Street, but we intend the Black Box Theater to have film capability. So, yeah, so arts films, you know, yes, they'll be that capability.
And again, I just wanted, like, I'm in a neighborhood with my neighbors over here.
Yeah.
And I'm totally supportive of this, and I'm excited as soon as I heard the building is purchased.
One thing I've sort of noticed that I was hoping in coming tonight that I might see more of, and that is the people we think we're passing this on to, the younger crowd who might say, hey, the Black Box would be a great virtual reality theater. We could bring things in and do things in there we never could do before. So as far as we'll build it and they'll come, this is sort of, could be potentially the North Adams of this area. North Adams, who would ever go to North Adams of all places in the world to go see the best art in the world? Well, guess what? People go, and they go from all over the world. In the same way, this can be an incubator for some young art professionals. You go to East Hampton or Holyoke to work up an idea, and where do you take it first? Well, let's try Northampton. The new, what do you call it? Arts Trust Building. I know that was delicate territory to be overcome.
It's the Arts Trust Building.
Yeah, so we need more of the people who we think are actually going to use it in the future here at these meetings.
This meeting was about the neighborhood.
No, I understand that.
You're right. I mean, it's.
You're absolutely right. Evidently, nobody in the neighborhood.
Our media made it.
Well, we have a mayor.
Thank you.
I'm that young.
I think we just need to make them aware. I'm sure they're out there.
Yeah, but we're talking about shaping the space and what it's here for to do. And I understand the neighborhood. We need to make sure people in the neighborhood understand. But I find it really hard to believe there aren't some of those people who find this a very affordable neighborhood who are younger, who aren't here.
The only people don't come to the community thing.
Well, they're right. They're not really concerned about the construction noise or the traffic.
It's not like
we're trying to answer the questions that a large part are in their minds or in their futures.
It's a valid point. I think a lot of people on the board. Let me do this and then go to Lisa. I'm speaking for myself. I recognize the fact, as I've said before, we all got a shelf life. I definitely have an expiration date and that the most important thing we can do is make this space, protect this space for the community as it exists now and for the community of artists that's coming up, which means that in addition to being a place where you can present work, we also have to make certain that it's a place where you can incubate stuff. And I think everybody's really aware of that and sensitive to that. And that if we didn't do that, we would have to some degree failed in our mission. Lisa?
I think that we have talked about, too, that we not only need to be sort of receiving requests to use the space, which is pretty easy to do, and that people will come and that there's a lot of demand, but that I think that in our programming, we have to go to the next step and we have to be innovative. In terms of in bringing in young people, we have to create programming that will interest young people who will want to use the space, because otherwise I think they may feel like, oh well, this might just be for seasoned artists, and we're going to have to do some work ourselves. And we've got two young people who are running the Arts Council now. We have to cultivate those young voices, and I think otherwise we could sit back, and there's plenty of groups who are going to come to us, who know us and have been doing stuff with us for years, but I think we're going to have to do some curating ourselves and to initiate some innovative ways of corralling some of those young people around and giving them opportunities. They can come and do things here that at really affordable rates. So
I think also for me something that's important is not only providing space once the building is open, but I'm definitely interested in pursuing certain avenues to have some of those people also be in conversation about the planning of the building, imagining its uses, and there are a number of young designers and landscape designers even, and these kinds of things, who are thinking in innovative ways. And so I'm definitely interested even in that part of it too, because it and people having a voice and an opinion in that, not just because they are older and have been here for such a long time, but they might have different ideas and new ideas and ways of thinking about the space that they have. I'm hoping it grew in that as well.
Can I ask a question?
Please.
Since this is staying here, have a big blowout party and invite all the artists to come to it.
And one of our neighbors is the Roos, so
I think it's a great night. We've been doing some events, and there are certain issues with if you all give us permission to have a really good party.
There's been some question about one thing about the tin can that we're in right now. The really big party has sort of a vibrating thing that happens throughout the neighborhood. It's been a little bit reluctant, but glad you mentioned it.
I'm here from the World Free Neighborhood Association. We have free food, World Free Food.
That's the most people you see together.
It's not like a really big party, but we have. actually Friday night on Arts Night Out, we're having another open. We've had like one sort of large and two, this will be our third open house, and now we're actually like in the stages of planning one in October as well. So it's a regular, we're trying on regular Arts Night Out to just open the building. It's not the same thing as a big blowout party with free food and lots of music, but we are making an effort to welcome the neighborhood and artists in here. So, but I like your idea.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's a great opposite idea. I mean, I know in other fields, there might be a bistro or things like that, you know, where it's not necessarily a blow up bash, but where people who are, you know, either digital media or online publishing or whatever, just kind of get together and socialize. And there have been other things like that in Northampton. I suspect if you have any targeted toward young artists, you get a lot of people interested. Just networking and seeing who else is out there doing the same work.
Anyone have anything else? Say 15, close to 30.
We don't have a date for the planning board yet, do we?
It'll be late October.
I was just going to suggest that when we have that date, Ryan will let you know, although you might know anyway, and then you can spread the word to the community, because if people want to come and speak in support, I would say, yep. So if you want to come and speak against it, don't come back. If you want to come to the point, yeah, that would be good.
Yeah, please do it.
Yeah.
And I mean, I would just say, first of all, thanks for y'all coming. We may do this again. I don't know. But, you know, consider yourselves ambassadors if you want to play that role. Because, you know, the more people we have saying good things and explaining what we're about, the better. Just makes our job easier.
Do different members of the board have different roles here to play? I kind of know Tom, but.
He's not on the board. Sorry.
He's
the architect.
All right, well. All right.
He's definitely a paid member. He's a paid member of the board.
Here's my question. Okay, suppose you said, well, wouldn't it be a good idea to go to National Grid and have them put on your roof with solar cells on, have them pay for it? And then let them reap the profits of the money, you know, whatever. Where do you put ideas like that? Or is there a place?
There's a website, and you can always contact us, the Northampton Community Arts Trust.
So there's no one really like looking at it's too early in the grand
prize. We're looking at a lot of those. We actually, we are working with
National Grid already.
We're
doing
that.
Yeah.
And there's another big energy conservation grant that we're going after.
All right.
Now.
Yeah.
So there's been a lot of.
So I need to go to your website and pay attention.
Yeah,
to
yeah.
Well, if you're looking to get in touch with us, well,
sure, you know how to get in touch with anybody.
We've been in touch with National Grid.
No, but let me say, you know, come to any of us. Or,
yeah.
Okay.
You know enough of us, right? That
yeah, I mean, we don't have our email addresses at the website. We do have the info at the U.S. Trust or whatever it is. But, I mean, if you want to get an email to me, you go to the website and you fill that out. It comes to me and I see all the usual projects. And so, in various roles on the board, I'm the president, which, you know, I'm sort of master of ceremonies and whatnot. And if it should go to a specific person, I'll figure out the best person for that, because I'm certainly not the best person for a lot of stuff.
But we are going to be having a planning session with National Grid, and I think next week. To go over all the energy efficiency issues and how they can contribute to the building.
Yeah, they have a program where they'll help cover some costs. Yeah. So we're in that for sure. And we have a $500,000 application into the Department of Energy and Safety for competitive grants. I don't know what our chances are, but you know, we put it together and that's all I got.
Any reports?
Yes.
We're having an open house this weekend, but we've got next weekend, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Real Life Theater, and then we have We have the Connecticut River Valley Poets Theater. And then, of course, we have Bach to Baghdad, which is a wonderful. And Peter Blanchett is going to be playing here on the 28th of September, and it's a collaboration with Peter and the Iraqi Children's Art Exchange. It's kind of a big, so it's on websites and it's out there. So we actually have a lot of activities that are happening between now and the end of September. Lots of opportunities to come into the building.
Yeah, tomorrow is jazz.
Oh, right, tomorrow's the opening night of the Pioneer Valley Jazz Shears is right here.
September, Thursday through Sunday, September 18th to the 21st, Real Life Theater, The Lion and the Clown, a Rooney love song for Beauty and the Beast.
And that is young people.
Friday the 26th and Saturday the 27th at Connecticut Valley Poets Thing. Peter is September 28th.
Come see young people.
And then in October, we're going to have a stage reading of the play by Deb Marble and Turquoise.
We're going to postpone.
That's being postponed.
Yeah. We need to postpone it.
Oh, dear. I just have to tweak my calendar.
No, that's okay. Can't be totally up to date about that. But we're having another event on that Arts Night app. We're working. But right now, between now and the end of September, many nights of opportunity to enjoy things.
Where do you find out? Is there a website we just go to see all this?
NorthamptonArtsTrust.org.
It's also on the Northampton Center for the Arts website, too.
Center for the Arts.
NoHoArts.org.
There's anybody who still uses QR codes, there's a thing up there that doesn't look fun with one. What do you call it? Propaganda. I don't know.
Well,
a piece of paper that has information about the Arts Trust and our website.
But we also have, these events are out on regular press releases, and they're in all of the listings of the papers that you normally see among events in the Gazette or the Advocate or whatever. So, nothing underground going on here.
So, thank you all for coming.
Thank you.